Ladies and gentlemen and friends, I am indeed very grateful for this opportunity to address this galaxy of achievers and share some thoughts on the subject of this plenary session. But to keep things simple, let me focus on the topic of research. So the simpler question that I would like to consider here is the following. How do we move ourselves up the value chain of research globally and climb near to the top? And let me try to give you as straight an answer as possible and then elaborate. The straight answer is that it is only proper kind of research manpower which can take us there. The most important job for us to address is to expand our capacity in that direction. More specifically, we need to start producing a large number of quality doctoral graduates. Why do I say this? I say this because doctoral education prepares scholars who both understand what is known and discover what is yet unknown. They also conserve the most valued knowledge of the past even as they examine it critically. They invent new forms of understanding as they move their own fields ahead. And yet, the more they understand, the heavier their moral obligation to say, to use their knowledge and skill with integrity, responsibility and generosity. They are thinkers and actors, intellectual adventurers, and even, I would go to the extent of saying, moral agents. I would even go so far as to say that it is the kind of education that leads to an integration of mind and moral virtue we often call character or integrity. Consider this. As we sit here, some 375,000 men and women are pursuing doctoral degrees in institutions of higher education in the US. Over 43,000 of them will graduate this year from the 400 plus institutions that offer the degree. And now consider their impact on the US and even the world. Many of those who receive PhDs assume positions of leadership and responsibility in arenas that directly shape the lives Americans lead. A remarkable number of Nobel laureates from around the world, not just the US, receive degrees in US universities. 4 of the 10 most recent secretaries of state have been doctoral degree holders. So PhDs develop life-saving medical interventions, shape social programs and policies, and turn their talents to entrepreneurial ventures in global economy. Approximately one half of those who receive doctorates join the ranks of college and university teachers themselves, shaping the future of children, and some start preparing new PhDs so that the effect of doctoral education ripple out across nations and generations. In short, doctoral education is a very important key to the research challenge we are discussing today, and its effect on a country's current and future prospects can hardly be overestimated. If we agree with this hypothesis, it follows that one of the important areas of concern for us should be doctoral education, both in terms of quantity and quality. Now let me turn to the Indian research and development scenario. For decades, most of what little R&D happened outside the university system and the educational institutions happened within the government sector, whether it is CSIR, defense, space, atomic energy, agriculture, or medicine. Research in the private sector has been more limited and until recently was almost non-existent. This is because before globalization, there was little motivation for the private industry to engage in research, and most of the technologies were acquired or borrowed. This scene is now rapidly changing, and globalization has made it imperative for industry to engage in R&D and innovation on a larger scale than ever before. The pharmaceutical, the information and communication technology, and the automobile industries are the most visible examples of this phenomenon, although smaller scale changes have happened in many other sectors to varying degrees of success. This growth is just beginning to happen and, in my opinion, is still in its infancy. Another recent phenomenon is the emergence of multidimensional R&D outsourced to India, multinational corporation R&D outsourced to India, motivated by the cost advantage of R&D personnel, much the same way that the IT and the BPO industries came up through the outsourcing phenomenon. This, like the private sector R&D, is still in its infancy, but it is reasonable to expect that in the years to come, the growth of this sector will be fast, provided we can absorb the same in our ethos. The point I'm making is that as long as the driving force for R&D to happen remained within the government sector, incentives for its growth were limited. Even high quality university research requires sustenance from people who continually face new research issues and look forward to their solutions, mainly from the industry, either within their research teams, which again would require doctoral employees, or the academia. So no matter how you look at it, the most important vehicle of growth of the research ecosystem would be putting systems in place which would help educate and form young scholars. And today, we have an industrial environment where the need for such talent is being increasingly felt. And we need to seize this opportunity so that the increasing need for R&D personnel in the private sector and the general societal need for a large number of educated, disciplined leaders are simultaneously met. If properly executed, this can generate a positive feedback loop which will sustain a growth by itself. Finally, I must say that the most important and a major key factor of this growth would lie in our ability to attract the best talent to come forward for research careers. We believe this is possible and would happen if young people perceive two things: an exciting opportunity to be creative and be able to work on problems which would have great impact on society, but equally importantly, they should see career and compensation opportunities which are at least equal to those in sectors like management and finance. Filling a bigger pipe with research students would only be possible if the students see through the end of this pipe a vision which promises them greater and exciting career opportunities. There is perhaps also a need for nurturing value systems which enable students to evaluate alternatives in opportunities and inner interests so that they could look beyond money as a driving force for all choices that they make. At the same time, there is a need to rethink the cliched opinion in our country that the goddesses of Saraswati and Lakshmi cannot live together in harmony. The private sector can make it happen, and I think that's what we need to work for. So, ladies and gentlemen, I submit that if we need to become global leaders in research, we need to create a much larger number of stewards of disciplines, so to say, by scaling up our doctoral programs in quality and quantity. If we follow the single point agenda for some time, many other things will follow by themselves. Thank you for your kind attention, and we look forward to your questions.